a very great pleasure in welcoming Eamon Gilmore, the Thomist of our country, to address you.
Good morning, Jack, and good morning, delegates. If I was the owner of that car, I wouldn't dream of putting my hand up. I'll admit that I'd left the lights flashing all night. I want to thank you for the invitation to address the conference here today. It's a privilege to address the biennial conference of SIPTU, my own union. I've been a proud member of this union and its predecessor for over 35 years. And I plan to be, if you'll still have me, for a very long time to come. I know that these are tough times to be a union organizer, shop steward, or a section committee member. I understand how hard it is to bring bad news to your members about jobs being lost, about employments closing, pay being cut, pension entitlements disappearing. I understand it because during the recession of the 1980s, I did the job that you are doing as a full-time official, the then IGGWU. And the memories will never leave me of sitting in workplaces, canteens, talking through those difficult times with workers who were losing their jobs, and some of whom thought they'd never work again. The 80s were bad, but if anything, I think the circumstances of this recession are worse, and I appreciate just how difficult your job is. In many ways, the job that I have to do in government is somewhat similar, and I'm often reminded, as I do that work, of my time as a full-time official of this union. And one thing I have never forgotten is a piece of advice on the first day that I started working for the union. I met Tony Walsh and Michael Wall last night as I came in, and they both started with me around the same time, so maybe they remember the same advice. It was advice that we got from the late Michael Mullen, who was then the General Secretary of the union, and it was simply this. He told us, never tell lies to the members. It's a principle that sustained me through my time working for the union, and one that I constantly try to live by as a public representative. And that is why I believe now in levelling with people about the depth of our economic crisis and about what we have to do to get out of it, and that there is no magic wand. On the day that we walked in to government buildings last March, our country was broke. Nobody would lend money to this state except the IMF, EU and the ECB, and nobody would put money into our banks except the ECB. The scale and the depth of the crisis that the government found when we came into office in March was appalling. The very apparatus of the state was in many ways dysfunctional, because it had no political leadership, no strategic direction, no coordination across key agencies, no plan to fix the banks. Ireland was simply in an EU IMF programme which was providing cash to pay the bills, but at high rates of interest. And our reputation abroad was, to put it mildly, in tatters. Last March, Ireland had few, if any, friends left. And it is no exaggeration to say that in those months of the spring and early summer, the future of our country hung in the balance. Labour, of course, could have walked away. We had just had, in February, the best election result that Labour has ever had in its history. We emerged from the election as the second largest party in the state. In the normal times, it would have fallen to us to lead the opposition. But Labour never has and never will walk away from its responsibilities. And we took on the responsibility last March of forming a government, a national coalition a partnership of the two largest parties in the state, whose job it is to fix the problem, a mandate to fix the economy, to get people back to work, and that is the true test for this government. We began on our first day by getting a grip on economic policy. We formed the Economic Management Council, consisting of the Taoiseach, myself, the Minister for Finance, and the Minister for Public Expenditure and Reform, Brendan Howell. The job of that council is to coordinate the government's response to the crisis. Our strategy was not just to renegotiate the EU-IMF deal overnight, but to take a strategic approach to it. It required us to make difficult decisions, implementing a budget that we didn't write, restructuring and recapitalising the banking system, and at the same time, mending fences with our European partners, which involved major diplomatic work abroad. It wasn't easy, and it wasn't dramatic, but it is working. Slowly but surely, we are starting to get results. The deal that Ireland did with our European partners on the 21st of July gave us a large reduction in the interest that we are paying on our loans. We saved a further 5 billion in the way we managed the recapitalisation of the banks, sharing the burden with bondholders and getting in outside investment. International perceptions of Ireland are improving as we take the tough decisions and get the message out that there is a new government that means to solve the problem. The cost of borrowing for government debt on secondary markets has fallen from 14% to less than 8% over the past few months, and in July, deposits increased in our banking system. These are the first signs of stability returning to the financial system. There is other good news for the economy. Unemployment is stabilising. Figures which will be published later today will show the biggest drop in unemployment in 4 years. We have now had two quarters of positive economic growth. And yesterday's Exchequer returns shows that revenue is on track. That is all good news, better news than we've had in some time, but it is just a beginning. There is more that needs to be done, and some of it will be very difficult. There is going to be a tough budget this year and next year, and there is no getting away from those difficult decisions. But we are starting to see the results of hard work and the right decisions. And let's also be clear about one thing. This economy will recover. This is a good country. We have tremendous human and economic resources. There is no reason why we cannot build an economy and a society that sustains employment for our young people and decent living standards. The true measure of success for this government does not lie in bond yields, in GDP or financial stability, vital though they are. The true measure of success lies in tackling the problems that confront working people and their families. The things that really matter are having a job, keeping your home and having a decent living standard. And that is why, for example, one of the first priorities of this government, which we implemented, was to reverse the cut in the national minimum wage. Within 100 days of coming to office, we brought in a jobs initiative. We cut the VAT rate for tourism and hospitality because they are job-rich sectors which can bring in some money from abroad. We provided 20,000 additional training places, including a new internship scheme, JobBridge. We provided money for immediate construction work in schools and on the roads to generate activity around the country. Last week, the government announced progress on our strategic investment strategy. Firstly, we are setting up a strategic investment fund that will work to invest money from the National Pension Reserve Fund in the Irish economy, and which will be the forerunner of the Strategic Investment Bank. It will be based in the NTMA, and it will look for matching commercial investment from the private sector. Secondly, the government has created New Era, a shareholder executive, modelled on the body set up by Gordon Brown in the UK. It will take a whole portfolio approach to managing the semi-state companies, including in examining their investment plans. I am strongly committed to ensuring that we have a thriving semi-state sector playing a key role in the Irish economy, but it has to be managed. For 14 years, the last government neglected the semi-states. They didn't manage them, they didn't coordinate them, and we cannot afford that drift any longer. If we want a strong semi-state sector that creates jobs and invests in the Irish economy, then we have to drive it. We are working to create jobs and we are working to tackle the mortgage arrears crisis. When the recession first hit, the people started falling behind in their mortgage payments. And the only solution available at that time was forbearance. People in trouble began to make arrangements with the banks to pay what they could until times got better. I have been a strong supporter of that approach because I believe that the greatest fear people have, not just in losing their job, it is losing their home. Some of those people will sort themselves out by getting another job, but some of them won't. And we can't keep people in limbo forever. What needs to happen now is for people to start working out more permanent solutions so that they can get on with their lives. To find ways to help that, to make that happen, the government set up the Keen Group, which is due to report shortly. And that report will recommend solutions that are based on a case-by-case approach, looking at the circumstances of each individual family. Those who can pay their mortgage should do so, but we also need a more level playing field for people who are negotiating with the banks about mortgage arrears. So as well as looking at new options for people in difficulties, we are looking at ways to provide better support structures to guide people and inform them about their options. These are difficult times, and there are no easy solutions. We are facing into a difficult budget next year, and in all probability the year after that. But I've always been convinced of the basic principle on which this movement was founded, that we can overcome any difficulties if we confront them as far as possible together, if we act fairly and in solidarity, and if we are guided by a vision of a better future for our children. To put those principles into action at national level, I believe that it is important that the government engage in a meaningful dialogue with the trade union movement. Your General President has spoken to me about the need for the government to listen to the trade unions and the other social partners. So too has David Begg, the General Secretary of the ICTU. What we are talking about is not a return to the social partnership structures that existed in the past, but there are real benefits for a country like Ireland from effective social dialogue in terms of greater certainty for investors, maintaining industrial peace, and strengthening social solidarity. So today I'm pleased to tell you that the government intends to initiate a process of dialogue and engagement with the social partners. Starting in November, the government will invite the trade union movement and the employer organisations and other social partner organisations to bilateral meetings involving senior government ministers, including the Taoiseach, myself and other ministers. Our intention is that these meetings will take place on a periodic basis, focusing on matters of current concern. Minister for Public Expenditure and Reform, for example, would lead discussions on public sector management and the implementation of the Croke Park Agreement, and the Minister for Enterprise would lead on issues to do with employment regulation. In addition, in order to develop a stronger role for the social partners in finding solutions to common problems, we will reinvigorate the National Economic and Social Council, and the Taoiseach and I will undertake to attend plenary sessions of the Council each year. Your union recently produced a very valuable commentary on the economy, and these fora would be the ideal place to carry forward further discussions on those ideas. We're not talking about seeking consensus for its own sake. We must learn from the past failures of social partnership, including the need to respect the role of government and the bureaucracy. But given the scale of our difficulties, we must also find ways to work together in the national interest and in the interest of building a future for our children. There is also a commitment in the programme for government to reform the current law on employees' rights to engage in collective bargaining so as to ensure compliance with recent judgments of the European Court of Human Rights. As you know, the Department of Jobs, Enterprise and Innovation is currently engaged in a review of the collective bargaining machinery to reform and streamline it. And I expect that the legislation to give effect to those changes will also give effect to the Programme for Government commitment on collective bargaining. In the meantime, we are working to put back together a functioning system of joint labour committees. The recent High Court ruling means that the system cannot continue as it was, although there are some who argue that it should be abolished entirely. But the government does not intend to go down that route. We want to see a reformed and modernised JLC system, and the Minister is working on the legislation as a matter of urgency. That legislation will reinstate the JLC and REA systems on a reformed basis and will ensure that there is robust statutory protection of the rights of low-paid workers. The Minister hopes to publish the legislation next month, if at all possible. This government is embarking on a major programme of public service reform, led by Brendan Howland. We are committed to building a public service that works for the public and which is also a good place to work. This government will not indulge in the misrepresentation of the public service that was bandied about at the height of the crisis. It is time instead to point to the value of the work done by our public service workers, from local council staff to the support staff in hospitals, many of whom are represented by this union. But if we are to leave the caricature behind, we also have to ensure that we build a modern, efficient public service so that we can and will win the argument in support of public services. The government will honour and work the Croke Park Agreement, which is the vehicle through which major reforms must be achieved. This movement is and always has been internationalist in our outlook. This union continues to work with other unions around the world to promote the rights of working people and human rights everywhere. Last week, I had the honour of addressing the United Nations General Assembly, and I told it that Ireland stands by the right of the Palestinian people to bring their request for recognition of a Palestinian state to the UN. That such recognition... while not a substitute for negotiations with Israel, would give support and dignity to a people for too long dispossessed. And if such a resolution is put to the General Assembly, where Ireland has a vote, in terms that are reasonable and balanced, Ireland will support it. That is solidarity in action. As I said at the beginning, I didn't come here today to pretend that there is a magic wand to fix all our problems. We all know that these are difficult days, but we also know that there are better days ahead. There are positive signs that we are finally achieving greater stability in the economy. As I came into this hotel last night, I met a group of women in the lobby. They stopped to welcome me to Ennis, to wish me well in our work in government. And in the course of our conversation, they told me about their children who have had to emigrate. And they asked me, will they ever be able to return? And I remembered, recalled, that advice that I got on my first day at work as an official of this union. Never lie to the members. And I told them, yes, they will return. Not immediately, but this economy will recover, there will be jobs, and there will be a future for people who have emigrated and for our young people again today. We as a government are determined to take on that challenge. The faces are in the budget, and that while the path we have to travel is still difficult, we will put fairness and the concern of families at the forefront of our decision making. And as we do so, we will work towards a better, fairer Ireland. An Ireland that has a different compass, one that tells our young people, we judge you not by what you have, but by what you give back. One where we do not, as a people, walk past on the other side of the road, where we play our part in international affairs on the basis of our deeply held attachment to universal human rights. And one thing that we can do practically right now to build that better, fairer future is to elect a president who believes in it. And we can elect a president who stands for the finest traditions of this movement for justice at home and abroad. A president that we can truly be proud of, and I'm happy to recommend to this conference and to the delegates and to the members of SIPTU, Michael D. Higgins, who is the Labour nominee. Now more than ever, the cause of Labour and the cause of Ireland are one and the same. There is a bright future for this country and for our children, and I ask you to work with me to build that future. Thank you very much.
To respond.
I want to thank you, Tánaiste, for making the time available to come and address us here this morning. We acknowledge that you have a very busy schedule indeed, and in being present here this morning, you're acting in accordance with a very well-established tradition whereby leaders of the Labour Party, whether in government or out of government, make time to address our conference. I want as well to welcome what you've said in relation to the development of a structured engagement with government and a facility whereby the trade union movement might input its plans and ideas into the process of policy formulation and decision making. I want to say that whereas it remains to be seen what precisely is envisaged, that we in this union don't lose any sleep over the loss of social partnership. We are not interested in any process which entails a surplus of access and a deficit of influence. We are interested in a way to articulate the interests and the concerns of our own members and of working people throughout this jurisdiction and indeed across this island. And if such a structured engagement develops, I want to make it clear to you, Tánaiste, that we would be approaching that from the point of view of the promotion of policies that are consistent with the requirements of economic sustainability. Because we know all too well in this union that the articulation of policies that are not consistent with economic sustainability are not consistent ultimately with the interests of our own members or of working people either. But that being said, we'll be approaching it in the knowledge as well that the competition state approach which characterised public policy making here for so many years is not economically sustainable either. And it has resulted in this republic finding itself in the throes of the third most serious depression within 60 years. So we would be saying different things, but we would be showing the people in government, both parts of government, that the things we have to say stand up, and we will be producing the evidence to support our contentions. There are, of course, enormous challenges faced by the Labour Party and by the government. But there are choices too. There is the question as to whether or not a way can be found to leverage investment into the economy over 2012 and 2013 in order to offset whatever is taken out in the budgetary process. And we have articulated in our document, Investing for Jobs and Growth, a way by means of which that can be done. A way by means of which that can be done that does not offend the public finances and uses the resources that are available to working people, that have been provided by working people in this country. And we would very much hope, Tánaiste, that the policy approach that will be adopted by the government, and particularly by Labour in government, will be one that eschews the approach of the past few years, which was about an internal deflationary strategy, driving down wages to enhance competitiveness, which is the road to perdition, and the record of history has proven that. And the second question that arises around this issue of choice, the talks then, is the way the burden of whatever budgetary measures are taken is to be distributed. Over the last 3 to 4 years, working people and people who depend on public services here in this jurisdiction have fared dismally in that equation, because the lion's share of the burden has been carried by workers and by the people who can least afford it. And one of the measures by means of which the government will be tested, the government will be measured, and in fairness your party will be measured, in the case of myself, our party will be measured, is the degree to which the imbalance in the distribution of the burden is addressed in budgets 2012 and budgets 2013.
I want to make you aware, Taoiseach, or to reiterate at least, the grave concerns of a 500,000 people whose retirement savings are tied up in defined pension benefit pension funds, who are frightened at the prospect that those responsible for monitoring the system might call in the funding standard to cover their tails, resulting in the loss of their pension rights for tens of thousands, if not hundreds of thousands of workers, with enormous consequences for them and for their families, but for the economy as well. And I want to urge you, Taoiseach, with respect, to pay particular attention to this particular issue, because once it happens, the situation is irretrievable. Your remarks in relation to the joint labour committees and the mechanisms that are in place or that were in place for the protection of the pay and terms of employment, and I emphasise, by the way, pay and terms of employment of the lowest paid 20% of our workforce. I want to acknowledge what Labour has achieved against enormous odds in including the commitment that this infrastructure would be preserved in the programme for government, notwithstanding the fact that it had been given away in a nod and a wink by your predecessors, and notwithstanding the fact that the majority party in government very clearly declared its intention to abolish this system as soon as it got into government. I want to acknowledge that, and I want to acknowledge as well that we appreciate how difficult it is once the High Court very conveniently declared that the system was effectively unconstitutional. Not for the first time, working people have come out the wrong end of the deliberations of our judicial system. But in acknowledging how difficult it is, I want to reiterate again what I said here on the other evening. I want to say that while we have no confidence whatsoever in the current minister, and it's not about the man's integrity or his good intentions, it's about his outlook, or the department over which he presides, which Patricia King described here yesterday correctly as the downtown office of IBEC. We have absolutely no confidence in those people upholding the rights or the interests of the lowest paid 20% of the workforce. But we have absolute confidence, Taoiseach, that the Labour Party will not allow the lowest paid, most vulnerable workers in the country to be thrown to the wolves. My remarks the other evening were described by some as putting it up to the Labour Party. It's much more subtle than that. You seem to doubt me. The thing about it is that a decision is about to be made which will determine whether an infrastructure which was put in place as part of the post-war settlement to protect the vulnerable will continue in place. That decision is imminent, and once it is made, it is made. And the only people who care and understand the plight of the most vulnerable people who are in a position to affect that decision, to influence that decision, while other people can make flowery speeches, including myself, the only people who can ensure that the most vulnerable, low-paid workers in this country are not thrown to the wolves is you, Taoiseach, and your party
and we have absolute confidence that you will. I very much welcome, Polish, that your commitment in relation to collective bargaining. And I do remember very well that when the second Lisbon Treaty came up for the second Lisbon Treaty referendum came about, that you made it clear to us that in the event of the treaty being endorsed, given its potential to address the constitutional issues that had precluded that right being extended to workers here in this country, that you, if you got into government, that Labour, if it got into government, would ensure that that entitlement was enshrined in the law of this land. And I want to thank you, Tánaiste, for the fact that you did not forget that commitment. And I want to thank you, Tánaiste, and the Labour Party, for the fact that for the first time in the history of our state, a programme for government enshrines that fundamental entitlement for working people. And I very much hope that you will live to see it being delivered, because that's something that only you can do. And we will acknowledge it very much if you manage to achieve that. And it is critical that when we emerge from all of this, we emerge from it in a place where parity of esteem that has been denied to working people in this state since it was founded will be in place in our legislature, and it will be in place because the party founded by James Connolly and Jim Larkin ensured that it was put there. I also welcome, Tánaiste, what you said about sustainable public services and the Croke Park Agreement. Our Vice President, Patricia King, led our negotiating team in the negotiations that resulted in that agreement. And she sits on the implementation body that presides over the agreement. It is a very difficult and unpopular job. But we see more in that agreement than just the guarantee that there will be no further pay cuts, or the guarantee that there will be no compulsory redundancies, a guarantee that our fellow workers in the UK would give their eye teeth for. Those things are important, but that agreement could offer the possibility of building a new alliance between the people who work in the public service, acting through their trade unions, and the citizens of this land. And we are determined, Tánaiste, to ensure that that happens. And that means facing up to people in certain positions in management who do not want to relinquish their fiefdoms, and who envisage the terms of the agreement being achieved in terms of savings and so on at the expense of the lowest paid people on the bottom rung of the ladder. I want, in conclusion, to identify with what you said before you completed your speech. I want, in conclusion, to identify with the vision of Ireland that you have articulated. I want to identify with an Ireland that is very different than what has gone before. I want to identify with the idea that the approach which resulted in the competition state, which resulted in the third major catastrophe in 60 years, that approach would be abandoned and we would embark on a new direction in Ireland. And we have confidence that you, Tánaiste, and your party will be the key to ensuring we travel on that new direction. I want, in conclusion, Tánaiste, to reiterate as well your declaration in support of our member and our activist for very many years, Michael D. Higgins, for the presidency of this country. Not just because he has been an activist of our union for so many years, not just because he was so successful in creating tens of thousands of jobs
and establishing Teilhard na Gaeilge when he was minister for a short while, and not just because he has been a champion of human rights around the world, but because he epitomises the values of social solidarity on which our movement stands. And I'm very glad to be associated with the recommendation in favour of Michael Deegan. And I want to in conclusion, to thank you again, Tánaiste, for travelling down here to meet us and to speak to our delegates and through them to all the members of our union. And I want to wish you and the Labour Party the very best in the very difficult role the party has chosen to assume in this very difficult time in the history of our country. And I want to reiterate again our confidence in you and in the party, and to look forward to the day when you will come here to tell us that you have delivered on all the commitments that you have referred to today. Thank you.
Paper there.